Hello. Heat and mass transfer and even moment transfer have great similarities. In this lecture, we are going to take a look at these and learn how one can easily go from heat to mass transfer and vice versa. Being able to switch between these two turns out to be a very handy skill that can help analyzing and understanding complicated situations. Prior to World War II, heat and mass transfer were separate domains, with heat transfer part of mechanical engineering and mass transfer of chemical engineering. After the war, when the oil and chemical industry started to grow quickly, unification started. In Delft, important steps were made by Hans Kramers, who made in the 50s lecture notes for his students in which he introduced heat and mass transfer in a unified way. In 1958, Bob Burt from the University of Wisconsin-Madison spent a sabbatical leave at Kramer's lab and was inspired by Kramer's approach. Back in the US, Burt wrote one of the standard books in transport phenomena, which is to many not known by its title Transport Phenomena, but as Burt, Stewart and Lightfoot, after the three authors of the book. Let's review the analogy we have seen so far and put it in a simple table. Transport of heat and mass is governed by very similar rules and ideas. We have seen that for both a concentration can be defined. These concentrations play a key role in heat and mass transfer problems. In both cases, convective transport is possible. A fluid flow can carry a concentration of heat and of mass, or both, of course, and in that way contribute to heat and mass transfer. Both give a similar expression for the fluxes. Flux or velocity, if you prefer, times concentration. The similarity is no surprise. The fluid, while flowing, just carries heat and mass kind of under its arm, if you like. Both heat and mass can diffuse. And for both, we have a diffusion coefficient with the same units. Finally, heat conduction and mass diffusion are described by rather similar laws. As a consequence of a gradient in temperature or in concentration, heat and mass flow from high to low T and C. In the general case, we use for both heat and mass transfer an equation like Newton's cooling law. It states that heat and mass will flow whenever a difference in temperature or concentration is present. For heat, we have as coupling the heat transfer coefficient H, and for mass, likewise, the mass transfer coefficient K. We found that we can make these dimensionless by comparing them to the estimate of H or K for diffusion. So we formulate heat and mass transfer in terms of Nusselt and Sherwood numbers. For flowing cases, these are a function of the Reynolds number, Prandtl, Grashof, and grades for heat. For mass transfer, we still have the Reynolds number, but instead of Prandtl, we have Schmidt. In both cases, transfer can be caused by free convection, for which we have to use the Grashof number, GR, which contains the density difference in the system. In case of heat transfer, the difference in density is a consequence of the temperature difference in the system. For mass transfer, it is directly related to concentration differences of species. Finally, the Grades number plays a role. It is a kind of Fourier number, but with x over v instead of time. Obviously, the right diffusion coefficient needs to be plugged in when you are dealing with heat or mass. But other than these differences, everything stays pretty much the same. Let's do a basic example. Steady state conduction of heat or mass from the surface of a sphere to infinity. For heat, we have seen that this can be casted in a simple relation. Nusselt is 2. For mass transfer, it's quite the same. All we need to do is change C for T, K for H, D for lambda, and we are done. This can be summarized as Sherwood is two. If you know one, you know the other, if you understand the analogy. Pretty handy, isn't it? Also, for unsteady diffusion, we have a very strong analogy. Do you remember the analysis for unsteady heat conduction for short times? Then we could formulate our findings in terms of the penetration theory. It was valid for Fourier smaller than 0.1. That is also true for mass transfer, but the Fourier number gets defined with the diffusion coefficient D rather than A as we did for heat transfer. We can define and use the penetration depth as a measure of how far heat or mass have diffused into the system. We can write the heat and mass flux in a similar way, that is, depending on the driving concentration difference and inversely proportional to the square root of time. And finally, we can cast everything in a time-dependent Nusselt or Sherwood number. See the table where we state that Sherwood is a function of Fourier, which is in essence accounting for time. Penetration theory has a limit. If the time is too long, the changes in concentration have progressed too much and we shift over to long times. Again, the analogy is very strong, as all we have to do is replace Nusselt by Sherwood and everything else stays the same. We have already seen that in case of convection, the similarity goes on. On this sheet, you see that summarized. At the bottom, we have an example, convective flow past a sphere. Again, the similarity is very strong and handy. All numerical coefficients are the same. Pause a minute or two at this sheet and let its message sink in. Let's do one more example, so you will never forget the analogy anymore. Heat and mass transfer in case of pipe flow. Here we'll deal with transport from or to the wall. We have to split this in two parts, laminar flow and turbulent flow, as the transport in case of turbulent flow is quite a bit enhanced by the presence of the turbulent eddies. These are absent in laminar flow, and both Nusselt and Sherwood are basically a function of Graz. This means Graz depends on the ratio of the actual position in the pipe over the mean fluid velocity, x over v. This actually is time, as x is v times time. This is understandable. Just flow with the fluid and watch your clock. What you will see is a kind of penetration theory. In case of a turbulent flow, the eddies are very efficient in transporting heat and mass. Actually, they do that as kind of taking it under their arm. No wonder that the Nusselt and Sherwood relations are of the same form. Before we do an example, let's take it one step further, the Chilton-Colbourn analogy. We will now also bring momentum transfer into the picture. For heat, we use the Nusselt number. For mass transfer, it is Sherwood, and for momentum, the Fanning friction factor is of importance. Chilton and Colbourn realized that for turbulence flows, the Nusselt and Sherwood relations for similar geometries are actually the same if they are first divided by Prandtl to the power 1/3 and Schmidt to the power 1/3. Then they realized that if they also divide them by Reynolds, the relations for Nusselt, Sherwood and Fanning's friction factor become identical function of Reynolds only. Thus, we have for high Reynolds number the nice situation that heat, mass and momentum transfer behave in a universal way, if properly scaled. Okay, after all this theoretical work, time for an example. We will look at a CSTR in which during the course of the process a cake layer has been formed at the bottom. This layer needs to be removed by flushing the CSTR with clean water, in which the cake will slowly dissolve. The question is, How slowly? We can find this by setting up a balance and find the flux of the cake material to the water. This flux will depend on the driving concentration difference, C star minus C in the tank, and a mass transfer coefficient, K. Unfortunately, K is not known for this situation, and it's difficult to find from a real experiment. However, a similar heat transfer experiment is easily done. In this experiment, we heat the bottom and measure the temperature of the bottom and of the water. From these data, we can find H, the heat transfer coefficient. If we do this at the same flow conditions, that is at the same geometry and the same Reynolds number, we can easily find K, the mass transfer coefficient, from H. Okay, to proceed, we need the steady state concentration of the cake material in the liquid. For that, we set up a mass balance over the water in the tank and back out the concentration in the water. From the Chilton-Colbom relation, we can find K from H. Thus, C is actually known. Then, computing the mass flux from the cake to the water is a piece of cake. And from that, you can set up a mass balance for the cake layer and compute how long it takes to completely remove it. Of course, you need real numbers to be able to do so. But you can do it in formulas without the numbers. Do it yourself and see whether you can manage. If not, post your problem on our forum so we can discuss solution strategies. Well, that's all for this lecture. Check out the glass plate examples where we will show a few cases and try the exercises. See you in the next lecture.